Alright, hi. Welcome to this week's practice, I guess. Can you hear me? Can somebody write into the chat if you can hear me? Alright, perfect. Good. So I talked about this being a practice. Probably means we should talk about the sample solution. I did talk about the sample solution already in a video, so I don't want to do that again. You can get the sample solution simply at GitHub. I also posted an announcement for that. So I will only quickly talk about this week's homework right now, and show you how you may start it. And then I have like stuff for only a couple of minutes, and then I'm done, and I'm basically only there for your questions. And Philip is also there for your questions in case he's needed. Okay, so we have the first, you have the first homework, and you can look at the announcement. And let me actually make share my screen. This looks like the right one. Okay, now you should see infinite big blue buttons. And now you should see the Jupyter lab. Okay, so imagine this is where I cloned my homework. So I just want to show you how I would start working on the homework. So I just opened Jupyter lab in a terminal. I made sure I activated my environment before. And now, first of all, let's look at the task description. Task description is a markdown. You can always open it in a markdown preview, and then it's nicely rendered. Okay, and yeah, the task here is to write your own class using the Python data model. So I explained, this was the first video I explained, and I think it's like the most important stuff of this week. So that's why this homework is basically only about this. But inside it, of course, you may need stuff like provide a lambda expression at some point, and so on, and so on. So you will do eventually a bit of the other stuff. Okay, so we have to write our own class, blah, blah, blah. And then, first of all, the constructor. So let's open the file, let's see what we have. So I didn't provide you with much here. So we only have the class polynomial here, and in this, the first thing we have is constructor. So we would start by writing a constructor. And how our constructor is, a constructor is def underscore underscore init underscore underscore, and then whatever amount of arguments we need. By the way, make sure that you delete this here, for example. So this only is there for an empty line. I've seen quite a few people which, when they wrote functions or methods, where we originally in this homework number two, we waste a not implemented exception. And then I saw people writing the code before the not implement exception, and then in the end still had the not implement, the line where you waste this exception. Remove this. After you implemented it, remove the not implemented exception. Okay, now I don't really want to show you the solution for this homework. So I'm actually not dealing with this. I mean, we can go through the task, but when I will show you the workflow I want to show, I will do that for the same homework of last year, because there I don't have a problem to show parts of its content. All right. So what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to write a polynomial class. Blah blah. No non-edge cases will be provided. Et cetera, et cetera. So first thing, a constructor. So we're supposed to call it like this. So you simply write a constructor, this dunder method init, and we see already it's supposed to accept arbitrarily many arguments. That means we have to use this star args, which I explained in the first video of this week. So we have to use this args, but look at the slides, it's just a variable which you can simply use. Actually, constructor is a one-liner, and it's just one assignment. The length, which is supposed to return the degree plus one, That's also a really quick one-liner. Well, it's literally the length. There was an error in the first version of the task description. It said 6 year. It's supposed to, for this year, it said 5 year. It's supposed to return six. So we have six numbers here. And if you have six numbers, because the lowest one is x to the, so something times x to the power of 0. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is why the degree of this one is 5. And it's supposed to return the degree plus 1. Why that? Because we could have an empty polynomial which doesn't have any arguments. And if we didn't, so that would then have to return negative 1 otherwise, and length can't be negative. So either the empty one would be just as long as the one with 1 in there, namely 0, that wouldn't make much sense, or we just return the degree plus 1. Alright, printing is a bit harder task because you here you have to make it look like this, so it's like can do it in like 3 lines. I think Philip actually made it in one, right? So yeah, you're supposed to return something like this. So I have a couple of hints here too. So you could start with an empty string, so you could define your string equals and then the empty string. And then continually add a line like this. So where we use this F string, so we loop over something where we have the coefficients apparently and the positions. And then we can nicely add this F string continually to the polynomial we have. And then we have this plus here as well. And now, because we would have this plus at the end as well, we would have to take the last sign away. Such that we have, so and that's why we have this negative one here. So only everything besides the last character, and that's in the plus, so remove the plus. And the parentheses above, I want this because it's supposed to have parentheses above, I want this. Okay, then coefficients are supposed to be an attribute, and the polynomial is supposed to be immutable in and of itself. So if something is immutable, that means we can't change it, and that we probably internally have to use immutable structures collections as well. So make sure that this is you really see what you're supposed to return here. Now you need to hide the actual coefficients attribute. Hiding, you've already seen this in Philip's lecture, and use the property decorator for accessing it. Then we should compare the length. This is simply those two operators. We should be able to add them. There is one error which happened to a few of you. I will get into that error later where we got an infinite loop. But yeah, generally you should, if both are polynomials and they are of the same length, then you're supposed to add them. Otherwise you just can return not implemented. Scalar multiplication only for integers and floats. For everything else you can return not implemented, so you need this armul and the normal multiplication. Accessing the coefficients. So it may be the case that your adding works until you access the coefficients, and then the adding doesn't work anymore. And then you get this infinity loop, but we're gonna get to that, like I said. And then in the bonus task, which gives additional 10 points, so if you have to fulfill all of these 8 use cases to get the 25 points. And then to get 10 more points, so you can either get 0, 25, or 35. Actually, you could get 10 if you implemented some of this stuff before, but not all, and enough to make this work, but this wouldn't be too smart. But yeah, here's a factoring method where you have this from string method. So I had this in 3 lines, and this line already provided. So actually, you could just write one more line, but if you take more and do it differently, of course, that's also possible. It's just not, so this is the hardest task of these, but it's also certainly possible. And then it's nice because this is a nice factoring method. So this shows another concept of what we had before. All right. And then I would continue doing this. So if I had now this task, I would well, start developing. But first of all, I would start by looking at the tests. And the tests are written that they are as understandable as possible. And every test, first test for three easy cases, and then I make random tests, such that you don't simply return something for this particular cases. And the tests are written that if you keep the order of, where are we? Let's move that here. So if you keep the order of the use cases, then the tests are gonna start passing one after one. So if you have the first use case fulfilled, this test passes. If you fulfill the second use case, this test case passes as well, etc., etc. Okay, and you can, if you don't know how something's supposed to look, like, it always makes sense to look at the tests. So this is what I already explained to you in the first lecture, is this test-driven development. So we simply look at what the test wants us to do, and then we continue making the test. Oops, where am I here? Yes, I will. Oh, nice that Philip is here answering you. I will answer some stuff as well. But first, I want to go through this, what I'm saying here. Okay, and so there are continually more tests, and then the first 8 tests are here, and then the last one is in this other file so that we can test it individually. Okay, now just how I would go about to make this. So first of all, how do I use the JupyterLab nicely? I've seen a few people who had problems with that. So let's take the homework from last week. So I would first open here the file. So in this case, it's the same thing in principle, because you also had to write your own class using Dunder methods. But it was supposed to be a matrix class, which represents basically a mathematical matrix. So we could initialize it like this, not with many arguments. Blah blah yada yada, not too important. So first of all, I would have the task descriptions open here, and then I would start working on the file like this. Well, actually, this is already. So this was not the original frame. I would always have a terminal open as well. Make sure that you change directory into the correct directory already. So homework 03 2019, that would be here. Actually, let me git stash out of this because I didn't want the changes I had here. So we did some stuff here. So this is the file as they got it last year. Now the first thing I would do is run PyTest. Actually, not that. I would run PyTest minus very verbose minus minus traceback equals zero. No, I mean. And then we see these are the tests. So I could then go into the tests here as well, and I'm seeing. So the test imports is one of the tests. That one passes because that simply tests if we are not importing anything unallowed. And, well, we import nothing here, so we don't import anything forbidden. And then we see that these here are the additional te are the tests, individual tests. And now we could go. So if I only want to run one test, I'm not sure for this homework it was that easy that you could just make the first and then it works. But so first of all, we have creation here, and then we have this test for creation. So let's only run this test. I don't, can I not copy in this terminal? That would suck. And then I run only this test. Actually can't copy. Oh, that's shitty. Test matrix colon colon test assertions for creation with constructor. Actually, I would want that where we were both true. Now we see this test fails, and we see, okay, we didn't raise some kind of assertion error when calling it with these arguments. So, and here it even says a comment. How are we supposed to do? So now I have the test, and this is how I would start. And then what's also always really useful is right-clicking on your file that you're working and create a console for this editor. Now I have a Python console. So this is a normal Python console. I can run Python code in here. I can you have to press Shift Enter to execute whatever you're writing in here. I can write 1 plus 1. I can write for I in range 5 or for print I. And this all works. So it's a normal Python shell. It's an interactive Python kernel. But it's connected to my file here. And if I Shift Enter, I execute whatever I copied here. All right? So now here, I have the matrix class. So I could now in my Python class write A equals matrix. And now this would work. And actually, now it tells me because this here needs some kind of iterable. So, oops. I could provide it, I don't know, an empty list in here. Now this works, and if I now look at A, I see that A is an object, an instance of type matrix at some random position in my RAM. Actually, I could even open a value inspector for here, for this one here, and now I should not see the A. Yeah, that's kind of broken. Maybe it works for you, maybe it doesn't. Not too important, but this is just to look at the variables. I don't need to because I can simply, well, oh, oops, not capital I, but I could simply look at I here or look at A, just my matrix. Okay, and now I would start developing and I would notice, okay, so I would look at the task here and this tells me that we're supposed to assert that it's not L-form, yada yada yada. Let me copy some stuff from the sample tree. So imagine now I'm working on this and I'm doing stuff and I'm already fulfilling these use cases. So now I see once I have the representation, which is necessary well, but if I call print on it, now if I execute all of this stuff here in my terminal again, and if I now run A equals matrix, oops, that's invalid syntax, and provide empty argument list here. Okay, apparently I cannot make an empty one, so let's make 1, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, if I look at A, I even nicely print it. And if I simply execute the constructor here without assigning it to a variable, prints it to me directly because this, like JupyterLab, gives you the output. Actually, I don't know about you, but I find it rather useful to have all these four windows open at the same time because in this one I could make PyTest. So imagine now I fulfilled for the last year, I fulfilled the first two use cases it was. And now if I run PyTest minus variable both minus traceback no, I would see that these pass already, and now I could continue working on this one. And I would check why this one doesn't work. So I would write PyTest test matrix colon colon test data that returns. I hope the error messages are verbose enough. This ones are. This one they're not that. That speaking, I guess. That literal. Okay, so now we would see blah blah blah. There's another kind of error, etc. etc. So this is only for the workflow. How I would start working on this. I used last year's homework because I didn't want to show you the sample solution. So this is what I have to show for this. Okay, now let me look at what you wrote in case Philip didn't answer it already, and then I have one or two other things I want to show. Philip, did you answer all the questions before this year? Ah, okay, this was not much. Okay, the args and the keyword arguments. Okay, let's. How do I. Oops. Make a new. You could make it a notebook. Okay, and if it's a notebook, I don't want the other stuff to be in my way here. Let me just close it. So, the thing is, if you have a function, then. So, normally, if you have some kind of function, you could provide it. So, first param, second param. I could work with my first param and my second param, right? So this is now an existing function, and now I call my func with, for example, the arguments 1 and 2. I'm printing first param both. I'm printing 1 and 2. And now, so imagine I had a function which I would want to call with more than just these two parameters. Then I could make. For example, well, I could make, for example, this function have a third param, and well, let's make it a default argument 0. So if I don't call it, so if third param not 0, Actually, don't even need this one, do you? But just to be more verbose here, print third param. So, and for now, I wanted to call it like this. This will work just as well. Now we're printing out the three ones. But now imagine I want to call this function with four arguments. And I can't. So what I could also do, for example, and how I would do it in Java, I would have to overload my function, write multiple versions of this function. So in Java, I would have to write it like this. So I have this myfunc with two arguments, and then I would have this myfunc with three arguments, and then I would have the same myfunc in case, hey, maybe you want to call it with four arguments, and then I have fourth param here. Etc. Etc. And this is really annoying. And this now this executes. Yeah, in Python of course this doesn't work. That's how it would do it in Java. So in Python, every function can only be declared once, but I can I'm not constrained to what my arguments for the function are. I can just give my function arbitrary arguments and arbitrarily many arguments. And if I want to do this, I need this star operator, and the star operator unpacks or packs a list. So if I have only the args here, so imagine I made my function like this, and now this here, if I have this star operator in the function definition, this means I can give it any number of arguments and it will collapse them all into a list of args. And now if I print the args here, so this I only need in the definition because here I want to collapse all of the arguments I'm getting into a list. And now if I print the args here, I see now I print two elements and now I print all four elements. And I could actually, for example, so if I wanted to copy my behavior of before, I could first value equals args at the position 0 and so on and so on. Position 1, position 2, and now I have here the second value and so on. And then I could continue going, for example, printing these values. And now this works. And of course, if I had more, so if len args bigger than 2, and I could also print args 3, 2. Now this print would print the same as before. So if I have this star args in my list of parameters, then I'm collapsing all of the arguments I'm getting into this one variable. And this one variable is then simply a tuple. And I can look at this tuple, I can loop over this tuple, and thus I can make arbitrarily many arguments. Okay, so this is what happens if you have the star, this unpack and pack operator in the function definition. I can also have this in my function call, and then it has a different meaning. So if I have def, it's like shorter names for everything. If I have my def foo first, second, print first, second. Now I have to call my foo here with two arguments, right? But if I want to make a list of arguments before, list of, let's make it short, let's name it arg list. I can make it just like this. Now I have the one, two in my list. Okay, and now I can unpack this. So if I now use the star operator in the function call and in the function definition, I basically do the opposite. And I unpack the contents of my list here and put them one into the first and one to the second. So if I now call foo arglist, this doesn't work because it's expecting two arguments. And I'm now only have first is now this list, and second, I didn't provide an argument for. But if I write foo and then this star operator arglist, this unpacks it before before passing it forward to my function foo. Now if I do it like this, It works because now it unpacked it and gave the first element of my list or my collection of any kind. Could be a tuple, could probably not be a set because sets are not sorted. Let's stick with list and tuple. Maybe I could even with the string. Yeah, it didn't work with the string. So that's funny. I have never did that before. Probably not a good idea because it's really unverbose. But it unpacks it, puts the first to the first argument and the second to the second argument. Okay? And now there's even more syntax such that I could, for example, so I could args, I could let take this args. By the way, it doesn't need to be named args. It could be named, well, no o in there, but it could be named any other thing. It's just args means arguments. These are all the arguments of my function. I could just as well provide my first argument literally. And then provide, well, let's name it other args now. Now I have a function which expects at least one argument because this has to be given, and afterward, an arbitrary amount of other arguments. So now I can call, well, let's print first argument. Let's also print the type of it. I should have shorter names, and then print the other args. Type other args. And now if I run, if I call this my func with one, it doesn't work because I can't type that fast. Now it works, and the other args we see is an empty tuple. Now if I call it with more than this, we see it works, and we see that the other args is full. Okay, these are args. So args is its subword and packs lists, so argument lists basically. And just as much as they're arguments, they're always keyword arguments. So in Python I can provide keyword arguments. So I could have my function bar, and that could have, well, first of all a normal argument and then a keyword arg. Jesus, keyword arg. So actually, I could use, for example, my original one. Let's call it second. Find this function, print first second. Right now, if I call this, well, I can call it just like I did before, but I could also provide keyword arguments. So this is now the keyword for the argument. If I call it, I can call it just like this. And if I do it like this, for example, also the order doesn't matter anymore. And it still has the correct order I want. Okay, and this here are keyword arguments, and just like the star operator here exists for lists and collect for lists and tuples, there's the star operator for dictionaries, and the dictionary does the very same thing for dictionaries. So it takes all the items of a dictionary and puts them into the keyword arguments of a function. So now, if I have, for example, a keyword dictionary, I mean, which is second colon. Let's make it B now. First A. And now I can call bar with this if I unpack it. Now what this simply does well, it takes this, it writes it down just like this. So it unpacks this dictionary and puts it into the keyword arguments. And you can combine the args and the keyword args, and you can, for, so I could do the same here before the before my list of keyword arguments here. I could also pack normal arguments, etc., etc. But now we see this is the reverse direction I showed you before, and just like this, I could define a function bar which takes, what did I do? I zoomed. Which takes any kind of keyword arguments. Again, the KW args is only, it's just how people generally do it because keyword arguments, literally, you could name it anything else. And then I could, for item in keyword args dot items, print item. And now if I call it with the keyword arguments, we'll print them here. Just like this. So this works for args and keyword arguments. And now if I add these args and keyword arguments to any list, So to the argument list of any function. Now this function will take arbitrary arguments. So this will take any kind of arguments and any kind of keyword arguments. And I said this is, for example, useful if you for inheritance structure, because you want the constructor of your child class to call the super constructor of constructor of mother class. And you don't even need to know what kind of arguments is accepted, because it doesn't matter at all. You can simply call super constructor, super is the keyword, and with args and keyword args. Now you don't need to know what kind of arguments you're getting. You can simply pass them on. And this is what I did for example, in the scream function. So the scream function here took an arbitrary list of arguments and keyword arguments, because first of all, why did I do this? Well, the args I have arbitrarily many because I want to be able to call scream with arbitrarily many arguments. And the keyword args, because I didn't bother looking up what kind of keyword arguments the print function takes, and I just passed them forward. But what I'm doing here, so what did I do? I called print, then the first argument was well, I for I in args, and then it's just, oops, it's just provided the, wait, screen, yeah, I have to unpack this too. So now I have actually both the reverse direction and the opposite and the correct direction. So I'm passing these on, I'm taking these, and the way I'm taking these, I'm passing these. This is why I need the stars here too. And I wanted to print i.upper. And now this works. And I could, for example, so now this provides the, oh no, this doesn't work because I didn't unpack it yet. So now I'm simply printing this list here as first argument, and I also need to unpack it too in the print function. Now it prints it the way I want it. So I don't care what keywords arguments I'm passing, I'm passing them the way I'm taking them. And yeah. Please don't.
Okay, so I got here. Okay, so I explained functions, you can call functions with keywords instead, and then the order doesn't matter. I could literally provide it, the second keyword is this and the first is this. And just as I can do, so just as I have the star operator for lists and tuples, I have the star operator here for dictionaries. So if I provide this list, this dictionary keywords, and I unpack them in my parameters here of my in the parameters of my function, this is going to do the exact same thing. So it's going to call it with bar, second equals B, first equals A. And that's the reverse direction of what I told you before. And just as I have, so this is what I do it in the function call. And just as if it's equivalent to the normal star operator, I can also do it in the function definition. And if I do it there, it will tell me, so I can loop over them, like I can loop over dictionary. So now KW args. Print type kw args, and in the function definition kw args now is a dictionary, and we see type dictionary, and then I can work with them like the dictionary. And now what the thing about, so the thing that's really cool about this is that I can now my function can accept any number of arguments. I could create any kind of function, and so for example, I could ask for if, I don't know, verbose in kw args, or rather if, let's do it like this, if kw args dot get verbose false. Now if there is somehow in my function definition, if I somewhere, so I could call it, and then I would print verbose. So if I now call my func with any kind of number of arguments, not the spaces in there. Jesus, no spaces. What am I doing here? Again, spaces. Oops. Of course, I need the spaces here. The quotation marks here. Now this works. And now, if I also provided the keyword arguments verbose equals true, and now it also prints it. So I can accept arbitrary arguments. And now let's get to inheritance. This is incredibly useful in inheritance, because in inheritance, I sometimes want my child class to use, for example, the super constructor. And now if I want simply to add stuff off, to add functionality to my superclass, for example, this, I don't know, this verbose thing here, I could just do that here in my child class, and then in my child class call the super constructor of my mother class. And this is cool because it doesn't matter at all what, I don't need to know what kind of arguments my mother class accepted, because I just pass them the way I got them. And I take the ones, I work with the ones I can work with, and I do stuff depending on them. And then I pass it, the rest I simply pass forward to my superclass and you deal with them. So maybe I would have to delete the KW args verbose. No, wait, how do this? There, KW args verbose. I can do it like this. I would have to do it like this, and now I could call the superconstructor. Okay, and this is basically also what I did in my scream example here. So scream, I wrote it like this because I want a list of arguments because the print function accepts any number of arguments, and then I have the keyword arguments here because I didn't bother looking up what the print function took as keyword arguments. I simply pass them forward the way I'm getting them. So what I'm doing here is, well, let's start with print I for I in args, and then keyword arguments just as much. And now this prints a list, so okay, this is, it's variable for variables. Yeah, it represents any number of arguments. So the, like I said, the, it doesn't need to be named args. It could have any args here, but what it does is it takes a list of arguments. So it takes a list of arguments and makes a list out of this. And the KW args takes a list of keyword arguments, or takes the keyword arguments and makes a dictionary out of this. Or vice versa, depending on if you use it in the function call or the function definition. Okay, so what I did here, in case it got lost again. So for example, imagine now this was the constructor of some class, and here I don't care what kind of arguments I'm getting, I'm just working with the ones I want to work with, and then I call the superconstructor with all of them. And just like, so I did in the scream function here, I did that too. I had a list of arguments, I didn't care. So I want to work with them because I want to be able to scream as many strings as I want. And then I also take this, the keyword arguments here. Why did I do that? Well, because I don't care about them, but the function I'm calling it with does. I want this to have the same interface as the print function. So I'm passing them the way I got them. And I'm only doing stuff here. So I could, for example, do it like this, but now I see I would have to, I didn't want to print them like this. I wanted to print them uppercase, so I use the upper here. And now it still prints a list because now it gets only one argument. So I need to unpack it here, and now I have the functionality I want. That took really long. Okay, but I hope you understood this now. Okay, then I have, so you can ask questions at any time. I have just two things. That were basically questions, rather that were problems of somebody. And that was, for example, that we had in the actual homework, polynomial dot, let's look at the readme. You were supposed to, when comparing, you were supposed to, no, when adding, supposed to return not implemented if it was not an instance of polynomial, or even here you had to return not implemented, it was not an int or a float. And how do we do this? So the way I've seen, hope the person doesn't mind if I show that here, I've seen some person do that, was asking like this, then do the one, and otherwise do the other. This is one reason it doesn't work, and another reason why it's not quite the most elegant thing. The reason it doesn't work is because of how Python interprets this. If we have this line here, first of all, Python has operator binding priorities. Just like in math, we have dot calculation before hyphen calculation, Punkt vor Strichrechnung. So there's an order, right? If you have 5 plus 2 times 1, you first execute the 2 times 1, then the 5 plus. And obviously operators in programming language need to have this order too. Here is one example link where it shows the precedence, so the order of these operators. And we see parentheses are the most extreme binding that makes sense, then exponent, then this unary operators, blah blah, then the normal operators, and afterwards the equals equals, for example, and afterwards not and and or. So how would Python interpret this? Well, this here has a stronger binding than this here. So what Python would do, it would check this here, and then to the result of this, it would add this here. So what Python would read this like, if type of other equals int, which may be true or false, depending on if the type of the other was actually int. And then Python would do or float. And what's the truthiness of, so now, so first of all, you can't interpret it like this. So you would have to need, if you want to have it like this, you would have to write it like this, but this doesn't work as well because then Python would interpret this. So this, the Python would take what is int, what is float. And if we combine two things with the or, due to the Python data model, it will call the dunder method bool on them, as I showed you in the lecture. And now let's check if float, then print float is true, rather interpreted as true. And that's actually the case. So float interprets as true. So what this here then simply does is it checks if type of other is int, that may or may not be true, and then it ors it with the float, and that's true no matter what. So we would no matter what do the one. If we had the parentheses around this, this still wouldn't work, because then it would now take int or float, which are both interpreted as true, so this here would be true, and then Python would check if type of other equals true. That's also not correct. How we would do it? Is we would write, first of all, we could write it, we'd have to write it explicitly, if type other equals int or type other equals float. Now it works. Or the quicker version where we can have int and float, where we only have to do it once, if type of other in, and then we have a list of int and float. Now it will check. Correctly. So. Print or float. Now one is an int or float. Now with the string, it doesn't work. So this is better. However, this is still not perfect because the type of other, so if we print type of other, now it's a string, yes, but it's an int. So this actually kind of works. But if we now make a child class, we just switch over here to see if you still get me. Yeah, you still get me. Oh, there's another question I'm going to answer in a second. If I now make a child class of my int here, class my int, I'm not sure if this actually works. If it's my int, I can't call it like this. Never mind. Anyway, the type. So this obviously for int doesn't make sense at all. But now the type of my a is a type, yes, because I didn't. And also keep pep 8, class names are always capital, such that we know this is a class name and I have to call it. So I need to make an object of this. Now the type of a is my int. My int has all the features that int has, if I correctly did my inheritance structure here. But this here would not work for, because I didn't name it other. And this now would not work. And this is why Python has the function is instance, and this is what you should always use when checking for types. So now you'd have to call it like if instance other and then int or float. And now this works the way we want it to be. And this is how you should always check for inheritance. As I also explained in this week's lecture, Python is duck typing, and generally you shouldn't often do this. In this case, it makes sense to check for the instance. Normally, you should only check if it does what you want it to do. Duck typing. Okay, the given function for use case 6. Use case 6 has, where is it? Element wise add equals lambda xy sample. And no, this is not a zip. Let's look at what it, and you don't need to zip. Let's look at what it does. Well, it is a function, so let's look at what element wise add is, or well, let's also look at the type of that. And the type of that is function. So we obviously have to call it this stuff. And we see, so if we look at it, so this takes two arguments. So element wise is a lambda function that takes two arguments and returns the following. It returns, and then we have a list comprehension here. Oh, there's a zip in there. Sorry, I didn't read this. So it returns a list comprehension. It takes the lists x and y and zips them. So the zipping is working like an actual zip. So if we have x equals 1, 2, 3, and y equals, let's make it, I don't know, 20, 10, 30. And let's look at the result of zip x and y. And what are we seeing here? Well, we're seeing this is a zip object. So I explained Python lazy evaluates its stuff. So this is basically a generator. I can convert this into a list. I can convert all generators into a list by simply passing it to list or to tuple. Now what it does, it takes the first arguments of both, takes the second arguments of both, and then takes the third arguments of those. Now I'm going, so this is basically what I'm looping over. Okay, so I'm chaining these here. And now this list comprehension loops over all of the elements here. And now if we loop over lm in, and then this, oops, why is it like this? Why does it, oops. That's funny, I don't know why it does it like this. And zip x, y, print, and then we see that it will first be this tuple, then this tuple, and then this tuple. So zip makes a list of tuples, or rather a generator that generates tuples, which we convert into a list. Now, if we can simply sum them, and sum simply takes any num, so sum simply takes well, a collection like a tuple, and returns the sum. So and now this works like just like this. So this here then returns a list where it simply summarizes element wise adds this literal element wise adding of these two lists. So lambda, sum, we could also, for example, specify as a lambda function. Lambda x, y, x plus y. But this is a function, so we have to call it. Why does it work like this? Ah, sure. Lambda x then takes one argument, except I'm unpacking them. So now this will work just as well because I'm unpacking them. Or we simply behave as if we had one argument and then would add, for example, here x at the zeroth position plus x at the first position. And then I don't need to unpack it. So this is basically the very definition of sum. Or that sum takes arbitrarily many arguments. Okay, with the zip in it. Oh, sorry. Okay, I hope this answers these questions. And I hope you can still hear me. Yeah? Can you guys still hear me? Could somebody please answer? Do we... Okay, great. So when you're summing two polynomials, right, what you're doing is Wait, if you have 1x plus x squared plus 4x plus 2 and 3x squared plus 1x plus 1, well, when if you're summing them, you want to sum the coefficients, right? And you can write this polynomial, you can simply underlyingly have a list of its coefficients. And if you summarize, if you sum up the two lists of coefficients, then you have the sum of the polynomial. So you can, so you need the coefficients for this, yes. But you can call this lambda function. Obviously I can't here because I don't have the function here, but you can call element wise add with this, it's self in Python, self.coefficients and with other.coefficients. And then it executes, obviously here it doesn't work because we, and I misspelled it as well. And then it adds both the list of coefficients and returns a new list of coefficients, which we may use for constructing our new polynomial. Okay, hint from use case 4. Okay, so when it literally tells you, you're supposed to make a coefficients attribute, and I explained the getters and setters, I think it was the second video even, or rather the third, if you include the one which was last week's stuff. So if you want to have the, so if you want to have an attribute like the coefficients, if you want that you can get the values from the coefficients, but not write to them, what you have to do is you have to make this coefficients an attribute. So the coefficients here is not a variable inside the class. So it's not, it behaves like one for getting, but you can't overwrite it. So if it was a variable, I could simply write a.coefficients equals and then write the values to it. And this is, we're getting this with a getter method. And getter methods in Python use this at property decorator. And what this simply does is that we have a function coefficients, def coefficients, opening parentheses, closing parentheses, which returns some kind of value. And if we write the at property decorator on top of that, this will basically make this function callable without the parentheses. This is the shortest description of what this at property decorator does. It makes this function callable without the parentheses, such that I can then call a.coefficients and it returns me the list of coefficients here. And if I do it like this, everything which I make a setter, I cannot overwrite. Okay, and that this is not possible is because this is supposed to be a tuple. Okay, so if I have my class something, and then I have my my constructor, I have one arg, and I set self.arg equals arg. Right, and now I call pep8. And now I say a equals something, and then some string. Self. And then I print a.arg. This works. But what also works is that I change a.arg to other string. And this works just as well. And if I now create a.arg, a.arg something else. And I don't want this. So what I would do is I would hide this arg. And how I would hide it, I would put a underscore on it that doesn't actually hide it, but it tells other developers, please behave as if this was hidden. And now I could make this getter function def arg, which simply returns arg, returns self.underscore arg. Okay, and now I can call a.arg, or rather, once I did it like this, I can call a.arg, remove this because this is actually a solution. And now I can call a.arg, and it returns me a type error. Isn't that the decorator? And now I'm confused myself. Ah, wait, don't take self. Jesus. And now if I do it like this, it works, except that self.arg. Jesus. Okay, now I can just leave it here. Never mind if I close it again. If you want to make a screenshot, you could make a screenshot. But I can still access it, but if I want to change a.arg equals other string, Python will tell me nope. It's not possible because you can't set an attribute, and this is literally an attribute. I would have to write a setter for this, but this is not necessary. And I did what user sort, it says this object does not have a coefficient attribute. Well then, regarding this, well then, what did you call it on? Because if you call this inside your class polynomial, so this is under the polynomial, right? Polynomial. And this is even inside some instance func, which has its first argument, the self. And then the self refers to an instance of class polynomial, and not an instance of class list. So if you have it in somewhere in this structure, then it works. And your self shouldn't be a list. So if the self argument is a list, that's not correct. Need to give me a whole code if you still have something that didn't answer the question. Use case 8. No clue what to do. A was probably the accessing the coefficients. So yeah, what you're simply supposed to do is, so we have this list of, or rather this tuple of coefficients here, and I don't want to, so it's not, I shouldn't need to call a dot coefficients, but I should be able, so a dot coefficients and then the number of the coefficient I want to have, but I simply want to call a and then the number of coefficient. So this is what you would do, and what you're supposed to do for this is you're supposed to use the getItem method. And the getItem method is the dunder method, which is called when you execute, so if you have, where am I? So if you have some object a, this is nonsense, but then if we call a at the position 5, what Python internally makes of this is calling a dot underscore underscore get item underscore underscore and its argument. Why did I say 5 and why 2? 2. So this is what happens. So you're supposed to write the get item method that it works like this. Okay. Actually, let me hide my screen for a second so that I can execute the sample solutions and show you again. Show the screen again. Oh, I have to cut this out and upload the practice. So now you see my screen again, right? Now you see my screen. I see my screen. That's because this without showing you, otherwise what I just did didn't make any sense. So now in this terminal,
I have now executed the code of my polynomial. So now I can, for example, execute polynomial. And now I make this polynomial here. And this, if I execute it like this, it will print the string representation of this because I wrote the constructor and I wrote the string representation of this. So once you did this, you can execute all this, like I showed you for the matrix class, and you can just have them here. That's really nice. And I want you, so what I want with the get item here is that I want you to be able to, so let's make a equals and then this polynomial. And now I want you to be able to access a at the position 1. And this is supposed to return 2 because, let's make it actually polynomial 2, 3 because this, like both coefficients are the same value. So now if I access a1, it will return 3. And if I access a0, it will return 2. And if I access a at the position really high number, it returns 0 because we were supposed to define the coefficients getter such that it returns 0 for all indices bigger than 3. Okay, and this to tell you, I hope this helped. And now let me tell you something else, because for some people, I've already heard that add makes an infinity loop. And this is of your own, so this is because of the way we did this with the coefficients here. Actually, it's really not good style to do it like this, to let all bigger than some degree return 0. You should raise an index error. Why that? Because now if I loop over my polynomial for I in polynomial, or rather in A, print I, and now this will lead to an infinity loop. Maybe I can press Control C. So we see, no Control C for me. Oh shit, how do I stop this? How do I interrupt the kernel for this? Ah, okay, so we saw this didn't work. So why did this not work? Because I told you about iterators and that you need in, so that you can loop over iterators. That's not 100% of the truth. You can also loop over over things, over classes, over collections, which are not iterators, but provide a get item method. So if you want to loop over something, then if that's an iterator or an iterable, or if it's an iterable, Python will make an iterator out of this. If it's an iterator, Python will call the dunder method under next continually. But if it's not, until this next raises a stop iteration, but if it's not, then Python will check if the class has a get item method. And if it does so, it simply calls get item with 0, get item with 1, get item with 2, etc., etc., until this class returns an index error. So if I had a class like this, which defined get item for some index, and then if this index is 0, it returns something, this index is 1, returns something, and if it's neither 0 nor 1, then it raises an index error. So this is the same as if I would try to access the index of a list where there isn't something. Okay, so this is why I'm raising the index over here. And now I can loop over this my class. And now it will print 12, 24, and then at the index error, this loop will catch the index error and simply stop the loop. And now you see the problem with my class, because if I didn't waste the index error here, but simply return 0, and I did that here, and I want to interrupt the kernel here, kernel, this runs infinitely. And this is what it also did for some of you in your homework, if you try to loop over the polynomial itself. And the workaround is to instead not loop over the polynomial if you ever loop over something here, but instead loop over the coefficients of the polynomial, because that's a tuple, and tuples raise index errors if you want to access a value that's not in the tuple. Okay. Philip, do you, was that enough? Philip, are you even listening to me? Infinity loop. Yeah. Okay. So again, this was because of bad design on my side on this function, on the method getItem. Do it on the coefficients instead. Yes, but wait. Why the return is not implemented, but you get this error? Wait. Okay, so let me copy this. Why is this still running? That's weird. Let me actually run that here. That is because the behavior, if you actually, so I said if you call this plus internally, that's automatically converted to a dot underscore underscore at underscore underscore one. But that's not, I think I have to refresh this because didn't I restart the kernel? Maybe only with the image. It's not entirely the same. But instead, if the a dot underscore underscore at underscore underscore one, if that raises not implemented, then the syntactic sugar around this, if you call a plus one, will convert this into a type error. Why that? Because errors are really easily thrown in Python, and we don't ask for permission, but we ask for forgiveness. So here I actually implemented this for int. So let's try to add a string to a, and now this will give a name error because I misspelled not implemented. Now here this will make a type error, but if I call a dot underscore underscore at underscore underscore and then a, this will return not implemented. So if the dunder method returns not implemented, the syntactic sugar around this will call a type error such that you can try a plus this and then accept type error to something else instead. So this is Python wraps this such that you can, in a better and more Pythonic and more elegant way, catch this. Because otherwise you would have to check the return value of this and try accept this. It's like it's in C always you have your errors are return values because C doesn't support exceptions. But having exceptions is really better because you have a different kind of return value, namely something which is an exception, so not the usual case. Use case 8 is, I don't know how much more I can help besides showing you, because what I just did here was literally showing you this for another example. So you have to implement the method like this and simply return the, so you have to pass that. So really, really often when you're doing objects like this, when you're doing your own custom object, which has some kind of behavior in a certain, for some certain use case, then you underlyingly just use really, really simple data structures, hint, hint, and just provide additional behavior on them. And actually, most of the time, you don't really change the behavior of whatever's under there a lot. So if you want to access the polynomial at a certain value, what you're doing is you're accessing the coefficients of the polynomial at a certain value. And I really don't tell you more than that because this is literally, and it's also again a one-liner. Actually, so most of them are one-liners. Besides these two strings, it's probably easily possible to do. Philip, you did it in one line. So Philip did it in one line. But all others are really simple one-liners. We just have one assignment or one return in the functions. Actually, for example, add is more because you want to return not implemented if you add something which is not another polynomial. So that's two more lines than this one liner which adds in them itself. Okay. So I know I didn't completely answer the question for use case 8, but I answered it as much as I can without literally telling what's in there. And besides that, I think I answered all the other questions. Is there more you want to see? Or again, you could also just ask for the lecture. I didn't understand concept X, Y, Z. Actually, stop sharing my screen. Did you guys watch the decorator video? Should have made a poll now. Just so I know. And still I can also check who's even still in here. Okay. So if you don't have any more questions, or just I would also appreciate general feedback. So I know this again was longer, but okay, now actually we even with this practice we are so far, but do you think it's too long? Do you think we should really restrict ourselves to 90 minutes? Also, is the way that we are providing the videos fine? Or would you rather have it live such that you can in the lecture ask questions? Actually, if we did that, then I would want to have some of this practice also be us explaining lecture stuff, because if there are questions in between, it's pretty hard to keep it to 90 minutes. I would also wanted to. Okay, but then is it still so? But then the question. So, actually, let me make a poll. Okay, so you all didn't watch the decorator videos. That's fine. Live videos where you can ask questions as lecture. Or videos. So what would you rather have? Because we really want to base this on your feedback. Why do I have the question mark here? Okay, you like the videos as before. Okay, but do you generally think you're doing like fine with the homework between lectures and homework, or is the okay, videos as before. So, Philip, this is rather clear. Do you think you understand enough? So do you think you understand everything? And this, like, having this platform with the meeting once a week then is fine if you have any questions? So, there are quite a few people here online, for example, that didn't ask any questions. So actually, you could write into public chat. So why are you here? Does this help you the way we're doing this, or is there a way we could do this better? Okay, yeah, this exercise thing, I mean, it kind of makes sense, but I also really dislike the player. Yeah, maybe we're getting rid of that. Yeah, okay, that's fine. Yeah, I understand the player is not the best. Okay, to those of you who answered, I'd rather have a prepared presentation in the practice. What would you want there? So, would you want us to basically do it like so, basically a tutorial where we do the same thing? So we prepare something small, which is I will record the recording for today. Yes, I hope if it worked. So basically, like. Other examples from the same stuff or something that we did in the lectures, or basically the part of the lecture here, or yeah, could write that in the public chat. Okay, that's good. Yeah, I'm also thinking, like, for example, here having another example at hand, which is kind of like the homework, but not the homework is. Sorry. Okay, does anybody still have something to write? Because if not, I would end this session. Thanks for the feedback. And yeah, if you still have questions, email Stack Overflow team, which nobody's actually really using. Use that more. If you're programming, use Stack Overflow a lot. Or forum or blah blah. All right, Philip, anything to say? Okay, then let's call it a day. Thanks for being with us, and bye bye.